because the young people, they want to know. We can't just say, oh, that's the devil's music. Well, why? Because we can go around saying everything is of the devil when sometimes it's not. And we need to provide something different to those who are seeking. So we're free to do anything that we want, but we are not free to go out and do whatever we want the moment I say, I am a Christian. I'd like to welcome you to session number 8 out of 10 in our Distraction Dilemma Music Seminar. We've covered a lot of ground, amen? Amen? So I have a question for you. Has the foundational information that we have laid for you, has it helped you to understand and hear things that perhaps you didn't hear before? Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, this particular message, again, is entitled Crescendo, and we're going to continue in the contemporary Christian music movement in just a moment. But first, let's have a prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to hear this information. You love us enough to share the hard things with us. Father, I myself had to wade through this and be convicted myself and struggle with it, and so I know what my brothers and sisters are going through. I pray that you would bless us with the Holy Spirit, Lord, and may we do your will and not our own, even in our Christian music choices. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we began in the last session talking about CCM. And so there are 5 different criteria that a song must pass before we allow it into our Christian ears. So let's review quickly. Of course, we have our music test. So music must be meaningful. It must be untainted for the Christian to listen to. It also must be spiritual. It must be inspirational, and it must be clear. It can't be trivial, worldly, carnal, degrading, confused, or disguised. Amen? Amen. Otherwise, it ceases to be Christian music, my friends. It might have the label, but that doesn't make it Christian. Now, I want to pause for a moment and talk about what we sometimes consider the gray area music. You know what I'm talking about? Because some people come to me and go, well, Christian, I don't listen to all that, even the hip-hop Christian music. I don't listen to that. And then they start asking me questions like, well, what do we do with groups like Casting Crowns? Has anyone ever heard of Casting Crowns before? I mean, this group is just sweeping the world. And you know what? Their lyrical content is par excellence. It is. It is Bible-based truth. Amazing. I mean, I'm like, wow, I believe that's inspired of the Lord. I believe they're a consecrated group that love Jesus and want to spread His truth. There are some issues, though, with the music. For instance, obviously, lyrically, the music passes. But the music bed many times doesn't. In fact, unfortunately, I think how many samples did we listen to, sweetheart? Something like 50 different songs of theirs. And there were only a few that didn't have the polyrhythmic voodoo beats in it. I was like, why, Lord? You can impress them to write such great songs, but why does the music gotta be there? And friends, they just don't know. I plan to send this to them and tell them I love them. I'm not down on them, but I want them to come up higher. Amen? Yes. So let's listen to a couple clips of theirs to illustrate what I mean, because I want you to hear it, okay? So the first clip is absolutely beautiful, acceptable, passes, no problem.
There's a way that seems so right to Him, but you know where that leads. He's becoming a puppet of the world.
So, the music bed and the lyrics need to match. Did they? Was it elevating and ennobling? Yes, praise God. Prayer for a friend. Love it. The body language, the motive fit. Didn't undermine the song. And so what the devil's trying to do is to get in with all these great lyrics and even beautiful melodies. And he goes through, and all of a sudden he flips things over to where it's supposed to be melody, harmony, rhythm, and he flips them over to where all of a sudden it becomes rhythm, harmony, melody. And he flips it around because he knows that it will affect our physiology, it'll affect our neurology as well, as we've already learned. Let's listen to clip number two. Same group. So now, what you guys tell me, what was that body language of that one? What would you say? Aggression? Angry? Sure. You see, so all of a sudden you went from this one that was ennobling and edifying, and the same group all of a sudden has angry and aggression, and yet they're still talking about Jesus and spiritual things. The vehicle didn't match. We have to be clear on what we're listening to. Let's listen to one more.
Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is?
Do you hear a motive here? It's telling you what it's going to do.
The man I've been rising up in me.
Okay, so there's a song now, it has a motive in it. Did you hear it? Okay, so it's telling you where it's going to go. Most of the time now, this is amazing what God has done for us. Most of the time now, I can listen to a song with just for 5, 10, 15 seconds, and I can tell a young person many times, because I go around all over the place, and they'll come to me with their music. In fact, a young 11-year-old just came to me between meetings and said, could you listen to this song for me? Amen! So I listened to it, and I said, sweetheart, yep, your grandma was right. It has the wrong kind of elements. And she was able to articulate to me some of the things that were probably wrong with it. Hallelujah. And that's what we should have, is the freedom to talk these things out, because the young people, they want to know. And we can't just say, oh, that's the devil's music. Well, why? Because we can go around saying everything is of the devil when sometimes it's not. Amen? So you heard that, boom, 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 boom. Now, you have to understand, this last clip, this one's called East to the West. Man, the lyrics are fantastic. It's such a message. And listen how it starts.
You know just how far the East is from the West. From one scarred hand to the other.
So right here. They flipped it right upside down, and they went from the message being the focal point, and they flipped it upside down and made the rhythm the focal point now. And this is now the new format. You start off nice and slow. You pull at the people's hearts. And you get in that third one, and you start to kind of build it, and you get in the third one, and you let it go, and you turn it upside down, and everybody goes, oh, yeah, oh, and we are being emotionally manipulated by the music, and then we stop hearing the message of the music, and that is, it starts out acceptable, and sometimes that's where I get nailed when I am on iTunes. Because you'll hear the first part of the song, and you go, oh, that's beautiful. You buy it, hear the rest of it, you're like, oh, they ripped me off. Because they went the wrong direction with it. I said, sometimes. At other times, I can sit there and I can listen to this song, and the motive, the body language of it, is built in. Sometimes even in the soft, more acceptable part of the song. You just know where it's going to go. So friends, this is where we have to take in account all that we've learned about music in this seminar so far. All that we've learned a lot so far. So we, even though we like this kind of music, I mean, I wish that they would just, some of these groups would just get it, and then they can go, oh, and they could remake some of it. I would be one of their greatest promoters to sell their music. Because some of it's so powerful lyrically. But the problem is when the basis of the music undermines it, then it becomes a problem for the Christian. Spiritual, not carnal. Godly music will promote and accompany a lifestyle of godliness and modesty. Amen. Encouraging the spirit. It will not encourage aggressive or sexual acts or promote carnal behavior. 1 John 2:16 says, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it is of the world." So even if it's a Christian label or a Christian group and it's causing the lust of the world and lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, it's not of the Father. The Scripture tells us clearly. Titus 2:11-12. "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present relevant world." Amen? Amen. You know, how many times have I heard, I just heard it this morning again. How many times have I heard, well, you know, I've got friends around me, or sometimes parents come to me and say, you know what, if I don't let my kids listen to this music, they're not even going to stay in church. Then friends, there's something wrong with their walk, because the music's not going to keep them either. The music's going to lead them deeper into rebellion. Amen? That's the reality. Music shouldn't be the reason we come to church anyway. Jesus Christ is the reason we come to church. And we worship Him. Worship has gotten so flipped upside down to where now it's all about how I feel in worship. No, worship is not about me, it's about Him. And we're going to get into that later. There is nothing more offensive in God's sight than a display of instrumental music when those taking part are not consecrated, not making melody in their hearts to the Lord. That's very powerful. In other words, God, I think, esteems music very high. See, as Christians, we are to be representatives of Christ. And if we're no different than the world around us, we don't sound any different, we don't look any different, we don't talk any different, we don't even dress any different, then we confuse the idea of who our God is. We confuse the idea of what Christianity actually is. In fact, those in secular magazines, they see and they hear no difference. And we'll get to some of those quotes in just a moment. The offering most sweet and acceptable in God's sight is a heart made humble by self-denial, by lifting the cross and following Jesus. So yes, it might be a cross to have to get rid of some of these things. And I'm not saying that even getting rid of these things is going to save you, because that won't save you. But it'll certainly make it easier to be saved. Amen. Anthony Campolo, writing about the Creation Fest, a Christian music festival, he wrote this: "Being in the back room with many of these famous groups," this is talking about a Christian music festival and Christian bands, "being in the back room with many of these famous groups before they go on the stage is absolutely frightening." Should that be our reputation? "The ego trips they're on and the language they use to hear their hate for others. When showtime comes, however, they go out on stage with, 'Hey, aren't we all together in Jesus Christ and the love that we share?'" You know what that is? Pooey. You know why? It's because it's a facade. It's hypocritical. In fact, here's something I want you to think about. These groups, these rock and roll groups, and these different kinds of genres that are in rebellion, that are in all of these kinds of non-Christian thought processes, these groups are being converted by their own music. Well, let's just let Crystal Meyer tell us that. Now, Crystal Meyer, in a response letter to a concerned youth leader, confirms the vile lifestyle of unconverted Christian bands behind the scenes. So she defends her own ignorance regarding the wearing of a t-shirt for her CD cover. Now, this is a cover of her CD album. And you see there, as we learned last night, we have this all-seeing satanic eye on there. So a concerned youth leader tried to contact Crystal Meyer and her group and say, hey, her people, and say, hey, we just wanted to know, why is there a satanic symbol on your Christian album? And they never heard back. So this particular conscientious youth leader said, I don't think our young people should listen to this until we hear back, because maybe Crystal's fallen off of the path, okay? Amen for conscientious youth leaders. So, she writes back to this youth leader, defending herself, and because she's not as bad as all these other Christian bands she hangs out with, because she's toured with hundreds of them. Here's what she writes. An insider look at what is really going on in CCM and how they are being converted. She writes, how about the huge Christian bands I have toured with that smoke pot and have sex with men and women that are not their husbands and wives? How about the hundreds of Christian bands I have been around that watch South Park and cuss like sailors? How about Christian bands that look at pornography? And then she ends with, I actually pray for them. I don't talk against them. I was like, I didn't know it was that bad. What's going on? These genres of rebellion are turning the music ministers into vehicles of rebellion. This is serious. Do you think the devil knows what he's doing? Guess what? The devil has come to church. Baptized paganism right there. The greatest single cause of atheism in the world today are Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips and walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. Mary. The gospel divas, Mary, talk about secular appeal, sexual lyrics, and their gay fan base. When you're a gospel artist and your music is played in heavy rotation on urban radio with playlists that include Beyoncé and 50 Cent, you've obviously entered the world of secular adoration. With ferocious vocals, doesn't sound Christian to me. Does ferocious vocals, does that even sound like it should be linked with anything Christian? With ferocious vocals and urban beats, gospel sensation Mary have evolved from the pulpit to the clubs. They haven't evolved, friends. They've devolved. You evolved from the clubs to the pulpit. Amen? Amy Grant, regarding her album covers and publicity photos, Rolling Stone magazine, she's quoted here, which portray her as a sexy, attractive young Christian woman, the Christian pop star says this, I'm trying to look sexy to sell a record. I feel like a Christian young woman in the 80s is very sexual. Gee, what did we discover in our secular audible history that was starting to really get promulgated in the 80s? What was it? Sex! It was everywhere. And the Christian artists go, well, I'm trying to look sexy to sell a record. Amen? Yeah, I believe that's when God says, I will spew thee from my mouth because you're not cold and you're not hot. You're lukewarm. You're mixing the Christianity with the world. And God says, I will spew thee out of my mouth. God can't accept it. If somebody says you're trying to go secular, I say, well, of course I am. That's the whole point. No. That's not the whole point. The whole point is to serve God wherever He calls you to serve, not to go secular, because as we discovered yesterday, that the secular mind doesn't even behold or comprehend spiritual things because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. Sheila Walsh, concerning her new album, Newsweek said this, that she artfully mixed the sacred and the sexy. Oh, yikes. You know, sometimes the songs sound more like they're meant for a lover than they are for God. A 17-year-old girl from Texas writes this: I would like to share my testimony concerning my experience with Christian rock music. And friends, I have stacks of testimonies from young people from around the world just telling us, here's what's been going on in my life. I had listened to this music with my friends and at church social functions for several years before I got my own CD, recorded by a famous artist. Buying that CD was the biggest mistake of my life. Why would it be a mistake, the biggest mistake of your life, buying a Christian album? Under its influence, my moral convictions began to dissolve, and I allowed myself to become involved in a relationship with a boy from my church against my parents' wishes. When we were together, we listened to, quote, Christian and soft rock music. It was all sensuous and destroyed my inhibitions. Yes, this is what happens when we listen to those things with that doom, bam, dum, dum, down. All of a sudden, you're like, hey, how you doing? And so we got two young people in the car driving, and it's dark, and this guy turns up the music because he wants his gonadotropins, the sex hormones, to be released. He didn't know this was happening, but he likes how it feels, and it turns him on, and it does the same thing for her. Before you know it, it's kissy, kissy, and everything else. And yet we tell our young people, save yourself, hold yourself until marriage. But we listen, let them listen to music that releases all these things, and they can't help but do it sometimes because the prefrontal cortex, the Christian filtering device, has been removed, and they say, sounds like a good idea to me. And then we go, oh, she's having a baby now. Hello? Is that taking it too far? No, because she's saying it herself. It's happening all over the world. It was all sensuous and destroyed my inhibitions. I'm so ashamed of what happened. The music made me rebellious and pulled me away from my family. I thank God that I can say today I have not listened to this harmful music for several months now. I feel a freedom I had not experienced before. You see, the lie of the devil is, do what thou wilt. It's the greatest way to live. And she's saying, oh, the pain and the heartache, the bad choices that I made. But now that I'm walking with God, this is when I feel the freedom. Here's the problem. We run to these types of music, and some young people use it as a tool for sin and for licentiousness. And so what happens is we go forward in our Christian experience, and we, oh, I'm feeling really sad now, so I need a song to lift me up or make me feel more sad. Or you know what? I want to feel kind of sensual and sexy, so I need to put on the music with my spouse so I get in the mood. Friends, if we need to use music to alter our emotions, then something is really wrong. If I need something to stimulate, I mean, think about this. If I need something to audibly stimulate me before I even want to be intimate with my wife, what's the difference than if I need to look at something visually to stimulate me? There is none. The point is there's something wrong with the relationship. And so here's what the devil's doing. He's saying, take my medicine, and it's going to medicate the pain and the loss that you have in your life and your pathetic life. This will help you escape for a little bit. Just take my satanic medicine. Guess what? It never fixes anything. So he's distracting us from our maker, who's the one that can fix it. Spiritual, not carnal. Godly music will promote and accompany a lifestyle of godliness and modesty, encouraging the spirit. It will not encourage aggressive or sexual acts or promote carnal behavior. So let's listen to some clips again. This particular one, now I want you to think about what's the motive, what's the body language of this song. It's entitled, Need You Like a Hurricane. And apparently, he's singing to God. I need you like a hurricane. I need you like a personal Lord and Savior, not a hurricane. I got enough hurricane in my life. Amen? Okay. A wildfire untamed. I need you like a burning flame. Imagine this. A wildfire untamed. In all the school Christian gyms everywhere. right?
I'm only yours now.
Do you think when the listener's listening to that, they're thinking about God? No, it's a bunch of pronouns. I need you like a hurricane. I need you too, baby. Am I right? That's really what the body language is of that song. I need you. We don't need to talk to God that way. What's the body language of this one? Shackles. Take the shackles off my feet so I can do what thou wilt, whatever I want to do, so I can dance. Listen to that.
I want to praise you, Lord.
What? Now, were you drawn to Christ? I may have interfered with that too. Sorry. But I'm just trying to show you, it's so carnal. It's this, oh, baby. It's like, oh yeah, I want to dance. It has nothing to do with spirituality. Now, how about this one? See, singing to Jesus.
You haven't known my mind. I know I've passed up the chance before, but I want to tell.
What's the body language of that one? Sexual. I need two volunteers. Would you mind coming up with me, brother? Yep, come on up. Thank you. All right, what's your name?
Sean.
Sean?
Yeah.
All right, awesome, Sean. Turn around. Just stand right here, okay? Awesome. Look forward. Good boy. How about you? Come on up, come on. Yeah, please. All right, good. And what's your name?
Desiree.
Desiree. Okay, Desiree, turn this way. Just look forward, all right? Now, look forward. Ah! She's a rebellious girl. No, it's good. Okay. No. All right, so just look forward here, okay? Hi. I'm so glad you're here. What's wrong? Never mind, I'll be right back. Hi.
Oh.
I'm so glad you're here. How you doing, man?
I'm doing good, man.
Yeah, good. How you doing? Yeah. Well, you're sweating quite a bit there, man. Yeah, it's all right. Look forward. It's all good. It's all good. It's all good. Okay. Is this uncomfortable? Now, why? What's the problem here?
You're too close.
I'm too close. She's right. I mean, you're what?
You're in my bubble.
I'm in her bubble. Exactly. Amen. I'm in your bubble. Now, that girl was singing in our ears. She's in our bubble. Amen. She's in that intimate. Yeah, that's the right reaction. Get away, dude. Now, how about this? How was that for you, by the way?
That was bubble space.
Yeah, bubble space thing. Was that uncomfortable?
Yes, it was, sir.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
because I was in your space.
Yeah.
And that is not right, right?
That's not right.
No, because we're men and we like girls. Yeah. Amen. Yeah, amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
All right. Put it there. All right. Awesome. You can go back to your seats. Poor guy. He's like But there's the point. It's not just music. It's not just the music bed. The melody can have body rhythm. The harmony can have body rhythm. The actual rhythm can have body language. And the actual vocal performance can actually have body language as well. So I'll listen to it now again. Now that you understand, she's singing into my ear. And you hear the... I mean, you hear everything that, frankly, you might hear in a very intimate moment with your spouse. Are you with me? So now it's even more because she's actually singing to Jesus. You haven't known my mind. I know I've passed up the chance before, but I want to tell you now how I love you. I need you. Are you getting the point? Yeah, I hope so. I was like, I got to go take a shower or something. Now, the point is, it needs to be spiritual, the music that we listen to, not carnal. That is stimulating, and it's got the brown, and it's got the doom, 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 doom. They just took the polyrhythmic syncopated beats and slowed it down. And it has the same licentious effect. It does not appear like dun 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 dun, or appear when you're listening to some beautiful song like some of the ones that we've heard. All of a sudden, it gets down here and it becomes very guttural, becomes bass, it becomes low. Does that make sense? Oh, I hope you're putting these tools in your toolbox as a Christian. So it's not just, oh, drums are bad. No, 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 no. Some seminars will only talk about that. Music is so much deeper than that. Now, that one was breathy and sensual. It was breathy, sensual, inappropriate, right? All that stuff. It's a microphone technique. You get right up on the microphone and you hear everything. Now, here's a couple samples of soft, but not breathy, not inappropriate. So soft singing is okay. At the end here, listen. You made my heart in grace to stay. Lord, make my heart in grace to stay. I need you, I need you. Do you hear the difference? Soft is all right. Even passionate, not passionate inappropriately, but like, I'm really, I need you, Lord. That's okay. Here's another example. It's a female singing softer. I don't know the way to go from here, but I know that I have made my choice. And this is where I stand until he moves me on. And I will listen to soft his voice. But it's spiritual, it's not carnal, it's not sensual. Inspirational, not degrading. Godly music will be expressive of the peace that accompanies the Christian life. If we're having a true Christian experience, we will experience peace. It will not emphasize the clamor, the confusion, the din, and the turmoil of the world. We have enough of that going around. We don't need it in our Christian iPods. Colossians 3, 15 and 16. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, and be ye thankful, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So true Christian composition will be in time. It will reflect finesse, harmony, and order of skilled Christians playing for the glory of God. Evangelism 1:38. The enemy will watch closely and will take every advantage of circumstances to degrade the truth by the introduction of undignified demonstrations. None of these demonstrations are to be encouraged. The precious truths given to us are to be spoken in all solemnity and with sacred awe. Audio Adrenaline and DC Talk. These are two famous Christian bands. A review on a concert by Audio Adrenaline and DC Talk in the Christian Conscience magazine said this, quote, an extremely loud and incessant heavy bass beat was the predominant trademark for both bands for the entire evening. The musicians of Audio Adrenaline stirred up the crowd as they thrashed their heads around and bounced around the stage to their hard rock music. There was virtually no self-control near the stage. This crowd was high on the loud music. Now, the author doesn't quite understand everything about what they said. It's not absolutely true. They weren't just high on the loud music. They were actually high because the prefrontal cortex had been removed, that moral compass that we have. And they lost self-control because the limbic system took over. Remember, the limbic system is where the emotionally charged memories are, where we feed, fornicate, and the fight are contained. And if these emotions are not held in check by the prefrontal cortex, which was taken out, of course there would be no self-control at the front of even a Christian concert. Godly music will be distinctly different, my friends. It will be different from the chaotic things of the world. This music that we have, it must inspire us. It must support the listener, not undermine, degrade, or injure the listener. Amen? See, God wouldn't want us to create music as Christian musicians that has great lyrics or whatever, and He would not want us to put it on a music bed that could actually injure His people. That they don't work. POD, payable on death. One of the biggest success stories in recent Christian music is the rapcore POD. Now, rapcore is a relatively new style of music that sets rap lyrics, usually screamed, to the sounds of heavy metal. It's not for the faint of heart. POD is good at it, though. The group originally had received little support from CCM and quite a bit of criticism when it toured each year as part of the Ozfest. That is an absolutely satanic, occultic, secular, dark festival of demonic music. And these guys are there playing with them. And so CCM's going, man, your music's just a little bit too crazy. We don't even want this associated with us. So apparently CCM had at least a little bit of a standard. They're like, it's a no. Suddenly, POD was on the cover of Heavy Metal magazine and was featured in the more cautious CCM, where the group copped a bit of an attitude, oh yeah, now you down with POD, where was you before? So eventually, because they got so popular and so big, CCM said, well, welcome to the family. Well, so much for the standards. Christ came to offer us salvation and to instill hope in our hearts, amen? To give peace in the midst of the clamor and the confusion and the turmoil of this fallen carnal world. To use words or music that is opposite of the peace that passes understanding is to wrongly represent what Christ came to give. Inspirational, not degrading. Godly music will be expressive of the peace that accompanies the Christian's life. It will not emphasize the clamor or add to it or the confusion or the din or the turmoil of the world. There's enough going on. And this particular clip, the first one we play, is entitled Comatose. And you have to understand, this band has topped the CCM charts over and over and over and over again. The question is this inspirational or is it degrading?
Comatose, I'll never wake up without an overdose. Oh, yeah.
What's the body language of that? Again, it's that anger and the rage. I don't want to live. I don't want to breathe. I mean, we have young Christians actually having that poured into their head from Christian groups. I don't want to live. I don't want to breathe unless I can feel you laying next to me. Huh? Is that talking about God? Well, apparently they say it is. Now, this is almost going to sound funny in contrast. Is my friend Daryl Sawyer.
Gather the roses, the lilies, the pinks. Think of the joys in your life. The briars will wound you, the thorns only grieve. So gather the roses, the lilies, the pinks.
Inspirational? Yes, it's absolutely different, and indeed it should be. Now, I'd like you to listen to these lyrics. It's a beautiful music bed as well. This is simple, piano. And I want you to listen to the lyrics and contemplate what they're saying.
If the Savior stood beside me, would I do the things I do? Would I think of His commandments and try harder to be true? Would I follow His example? Would I live more righteously if I could see the Savior standing nigh, watching over me?
Amen. I was told not long ago, just between the meetings, a grandmother pulled me aside and she said, "You know what you're talking about, I believe. And my granddaughter believes it as well. My 15-year-old granddaughter believes it too. Because she sees all this craziness, the flipping around, the craziness happening in her church, the Church of the Nazarene. And she says, I think I like this church better, and I think I might want to start coming here." See, friends, what the devil's trying to do is he is trying to make us just like the fallen Babylonian world around us and the fallen Babylonian churches around us. And we need to provide something different to those who are seeking. Amen. We must give them an alternative. We can't be like them, because some of people are going, "This ain't doing it for me. This emotionalism of whipping up my heart and stuff, it doesn't work, because when I leave, if I don't have all the music and all the entertainment in the church, then I think Jesus isn't with me anymore." So we have to be different as Seventh-day Adventist Christians. Because if we don't provide an opportunity, where are they going to go? We don't provide a difference, where are they going to go? If we don't provide an alternative worship experience, where are they going to go? They're going to go, "You know what? I guess none of it works, because they're all the same." No. Let's be different. Let's step up to the plate and deny self so we can glorify God. Clear, not confused, or disguised. It's pretty common now in the CCM world to veil your Jesus lyrics so much that you can't even figure out what we're talking about. So now, if the great claim is that the lyrics is the only thing that matters, and now we change even the lyrics, then what do we actually have? Secular music being played by a Christian band. Godly music will contain lyrics and instrumentation that are full of clarity, beauty, and dignity, worthy in the praise and worship of God. The genre will not cloud, that means the type of music, will not cloud or confuse the message. 1 Corinthians 14:14-15 says, "For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. I will sing with the spirit, I will sing with the understanding also." So it's interesting, it's talking about singing right here. So we need to sing in a way that people can understand what in the world we're talking about. I love this. When human beings sing with the spirit and the understanding, heavenly musicians take up the strain and join in the song of thanksgiving. Wow! So anytime we're giving a special music, we're bringing honor and glory to God, angels are going, "Let's join in." He who has bestowed upon us all the gifts that enable us to be workers together with God, expects His servants to cultivate their voices so that they can speak and sing in a way that all can understand. It is not loud singing that is needed, but clear intonation, correct pronunciation, and distinct utterance. Let all take time to cultivate the voice. How many? "Oh, I can't sing." Well, then spirit prophecy is wrong. We can all improve. Amen? Amen. Let all take time to cultivate the voice so that God's praise can be sung in clear, soft tones, not with harshness and shrillness that offend the ear. The ability to sing is the gift of God. Let it be used to His glory. Christianity Today commented that CCM sales were slumping because of CCM performers, quote, lack of spiritual commitment and meaningful lyrics. Saying, we don't even know it, what's the difference. CCM magazine editor John Style complained that, now this is their own magazine. Some Christian, quote, he even puts in quote, some Christian songs today are so veiled in terms of spiritual content that their meaning is lost to all but the most imaginative. Amy Grant. Now, here's Billboard magazine and Face the Music. So they're actually writing an article about Amy Grant, and here's what the world even perceives. The only difference between Amy Grant's love songs and those of Olivia Newton-John is that often Grant's pronouns comes with capital letters. I love you. I need him. You are in my life. You're amazing. And it's capital him. It could be sung to anybody. Now, here is a clip of a different artist with a top song currently, and it's called Hold Me. Now, is it clear when we go through this? I want you to ask yourself, is it clear who she's talking about? Or would Billboard magazine say the same thing? Capital pronouns. Would you sing to Jesus this way?
Forever in my heart, always on my mind. It's crazy how I think about you all of the time. And just when I think I'm about to figure you out, you make me want to sing and shout. I love the way you hold me by my side. You'll always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love the way you hold me in your arms. I'll always be.
Is it clear who she's talking about? No. So here's what we get away with. We actually slip under the radar because I'm a Christian singer and I just use pronouns and I can make whatever kind of music I want, and it crosses over sometimes in the secular market because, frankly, spiritual things are spiritually discerned. Never would you think, oh, she's even talking about, even if you have spiritual discernment, about God. Because first of all, the music bed has a whole different kind of body language, right? Christianity Today writes, many singers have softened their Christian message in an effort to cross over into the secular marketplace. But many now say this practice has damaged their credibility with Christian audiences while blunting their impact on secular customers. So here's the point. When we lower our standards, nobody wins. The Christians don't win. Frankly, Christian music is for Christians. The Christians don't win, and the secular market doesn't win because we have to soften it so much so they'll actually palate it. Don't soften the music, we soften the message. The Birmingham News wrote after attending a Michael W. Smith concert, if you were not familiar with Michael W. Smith's standing in the world of contemporary Christian music, you might attend one of his concerts and come out none the wiser. I didn't write that. The secular news did. He also said in the Wall Street Journal, of all places, quote, I know if I'm too blatant about my Christianity and talk about Jesus, I won't succeed. But hey, I'm not an evangelist, I'm a singer. On a blog site discussing CCM artists, a discussion broke out. And they started talking about how there's these secular albums that are out there, and there were a few young men who articulated things very well on the subject. So I thought I would just pull their blog and let you see what they actually wrote. Here's what the first man said. Quote, all of a Christian's life is sacred or devoted to God. For Christians, no area is secular or religiously irrelevant. Amen. What gets me is when musicians try to distance themselves from Jesus in an effort to seem more relevant to non-Christians. Those who say, I'm a musician, not a missionary, have got it wrong. We're all missionaries. After all, Jesus did indicate that he will draw all people to himself when he is lifted up, not when he is hidden under a bushel. Another young man commenting on the same blog stated, "It's good for us to practice discernment about what we listen to and what we support with our dollars. Musicians are indeed responsible to God for what they produce, and we are responsible to God for what we expose ourselves to and for what we enable through our finances. It's fine not to condemn, but it's also fine to judge for ourselves where our time and money goes." Those are young men standing for God. Love it. Michael Card comments on the condition of CCM music. He says, "The lyrics of a good number of songs don't say anything specifically Christian. They may have some moral message, but not a lot of the big songs are identifiably Christian. What happens to the message when we start getting the music to as many people as possible? Well, there is an essential part of the gospel that's not ever going to sell. The gospel is good news, but it is also bad news. You are a sinner and you are hopeless. That's part of the message too. And if it's taken out, and frequently in Christian music it is, it ceases to be the gospel." Amen. There are some people stepping up and saying, we got big problems here. So I've got a question. Do we take drugs to win addicts to Christ? Never. Do we use foul language to witness to those who curse? No. Do we steal to identify with robbers? No. Do we draw lewd pictures to present Christ to the pornographer? No. Then why do we use carnal music to gain a hearing with the carnal world? Think about it. Clear, not confused. If at any time we are listening to a song and it starts to pull us away from God to the musician or to the song or the way it's put together, it is a problem. Amen? Because our music is to draw us to God and to glorify God. So if at any time it takes over and we are drawn away from God in our thinking, that is a problem. Now I'm going to play a clip for you, a little medley. And I want you to be asking yourself, is this godly music? Does it contain the right lyrics? Does it have the right kind of instrumentation? Is it full of clarity and beauty and dignity, worthy in the praise and worship of God? Or is the genre clouding and confusing the message? This particular song, I can tell you right now, lyrically is okay. It happens to be a hymn, "How Great Thou Art." Anybody ever heard that little one? Yeah. So I want you to think, it starts off with a man singing, and I'll just tell you, it starts off just fine. And then we'll go through a couple of different genres with different kinds of body language. Same song, and then we're going to end up back with the guy that started it out okay. Are you ready? Ask yourself, is the genre or the style or the singer, the body language distracting you from God?
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars.
It works.
I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display.
So let's change it.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
It works.
How great thou art.
Let's change it.
Then sings my soul.
Christ shall be. shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow.
Are you being drawn to Christ? It's gone now, isn't it? Already.
Sings my soul.
Love ballad, right?
How great thou art.
It's fine.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
A little motive in here, listen.
How great you are.
How about this one?
How great thou art.
Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Everybody just went, oh.
How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Don't you ever let anybody tell you that the music doesn't matter, it's only the lyrics. There's Christian music that's of God, and there's Christian music that is not of God. It's as simple as that. Music, what a blessing, and what a curse. Because the devil has gotten a hold of a lot, but praise God, he's still maintaining some of his music on this planet as well. Music. Meaningful, not trivial. Untainted, not worldly. Spiritual, not carnal. Inspirational, not degrading. Clear, not confused or disguised. Please take these cards. Take as many as you want and put them all over the place. 21 Manuscripts releases 130. Those things which have been in the past will be in the future. Satan will make what? Music. A snare by the way in which it is conducted. The prophet of God saw at the end of time, Satan was going to use music as a snare, and she didn't talk about the lyrics. She said the way it's being conducted. God calls upon his people who have the light before them in the word and in the testimonies to read and consider and to take heed. Clear and definite instruction has been given in order that all may understand, and I hope that's what's been happening here. The Holy Spirit wants to back you. The Holy Spirit wants to help you. The Holy Spirit wants to fortify you. Stop opening ourselves up to Satan to mess with us, to distract us away from our Maker, to take away that prefrontal cortex, to put us in that alpha state of mind to where everything just pours in, whether it's truth or not. We look back and we see results in the world. And in the church, we look back at history and we can see every time that the church brought down their standards that it didn't win over the world. The world overtook the church. Today, every uncouth thing is allowed now into the churches. We've adopted live and let live philosophy. Don't judge me. I'll do what I want to do. And friends, we can do whatever we want to. That's the reality. Because this life is your life. You can choose to go out and be the best Satanist on the planet. You can. You can choose to go out and be the best pornographer on the planet. You can choose to go out and be the best baseball player, the best actor, the best singer in the world. We can go out and choose to do whatever we want. We have a what? A free will. God doesn't force any one of us. Amen? He doesn't. So we're free to do anything that we want. But we are not free to go out and do whatever we want the moment I say, I am a Christian. It's a no. That's legalism. No, that's responsibility. Yeah. To glorify God with our living. To glorify God with our words, with our music, with everything that we engage in. Because if we take the name of Christian, then we are representing Christ. We are Christians, right? And therefore, I represent a foreign land. And if I'm representing the foreign land with my whatever I'm representing it with, then I'm giving a false representation. I'm a false ambassador. I'm a false prophet. I am lukewarm water. What a privilege to be a Christian. It truly is. It's a privilege and it's a responsibility. And by God's grace, I accept that. A scripture that we can take great courage from is this one, Proverbs 24:16. For a just man falleth seven times, but he riseth again. But the wicked shall fall into mischief. You see, we've all made mistakes in this room, haven't we? We've all said, I'm going to be a Christian, whether I like it or not. Sometimes that happens. You're like, because we know it is the right way. We say, Lord, would you just change me? I give you permission. It's like almost like, take away my prefrontal cortex, pour it all in, and then put it back, and I'll be okay with it. But that's not how it works. It's through trial and tribulation. It's through falling and getting back up. You see, a righteous man falls seven times, but he doesn't stay down. He might fall 70 times. I've been here before. I was having a discussion with a friend of mine last night. He said, we were talking about how we had been there before. We've made these proclamations, and now I'm back here again. How did I get back here again? I know the answers. And as soon as we say, Lord, I need your help, Jesus himself sings over us, my son is returned, or whatever he says. Does God go, okay, all right, let's try again? No, that's what the devil tempts us to think about God. Because a righteous man falleth seven times, but he gets up again. So what if I have to fall 7,000 times, and then 7,001, I don't fall anymore? Hallelujah, all of heaven goes, ah. Amen? A righteous man falleth seven times. So it didn't say here, a righteous man never falls. Right? It says a righteous man falls. Maybe even more than once. More than twice. More than three times, four times, five times, six times. Seven times, but he gets up again. Remember, we have Christ's righteousness when we ask for it. And he'll grow us up as calves in the stall to where someday, friends, we stop falling. Amen? So let's stop listening to stuff that just pulls us down, that distracts us from our Maker. Amen? Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you, thank you, thank you for who you are. Thank you for your character. Thank you for the love that you have for us. Thank you, Father, that when we turn to you and say, Lord, we need you, you don't say, well, it's about time. You say, here I am, my son. I've always been here for you. Even though we stray far away sometimes, I know, Father, we're never outside the reach of your loving arms. I pray that you would forgive us for our sins. Cleanse us from unrighteousness, Father. Fill us with the Holy Spirit. And help us to have the courage to follow you, your will alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.